Now the story of a modern network with distributed hosts, and the one technology that has no choice but to keep them all together. It's VXLAN. You've come on a long journey with me so far. We're finally at part 5, where the configuration begins. In part 4, we looked at the two ways that addresses can be learned. One of these is through data plane learning, also known as flood and learn. In this video, we're going to configure VXLAN with data plane learning on some Nexus 9000 series switches. If you watched part 4, you may remember that I said that control plane learning was preferred. So why then are we going to configure data plane learning here? Isn't it a waste of time? We're doing this because it's much simpler. This is an easier way to learn VXLAN, as you'll get to see VTEP configuration, VNIs, the overlay, and verification. In part 6, we'll get more complicated and see how the control plane is configured. Let's get started. We're going to use a very basic topology to make configuration as simple as possible. We will use two Nexus 9000 switches. Each switch will have a VTEP interface. There is a single routed link between the switches. This routed link will simulate the underlay network. I have attached a host in each of these switches. They will connect to access ports configured with VLAN 1000. As they're both in the same subnet, they will not be able to communicate initially due to the routed link. This is what we'll fix with VXLAN. During the configuration, we will associate VLAN 1000 with VNI 5000. We'll also configure multicast to handle bomb traffic. We'll start with configuring the underlying infrastructure. This includes enabling features, setting the MTU, mapping VLAN 1000 to VNI 5000, configuring the routed link, configuring host ports, and creating loopback addresses. We'll start by getting our three features enabled. OSPF is used to manage the underlay. The PIM feature is for multicast, which handles bomb traffic. The NV overlay feature enables VXLAN. NV means network virtualization. Notice that there's a warning about a system routing template. The routing template is how the Nexus formats certain data structures in memory. On the 9000 series platform, this is required on version 703, i5.1 and earlier. Newer versions can take care of this transparently, so you won't get this warning. The VN segment VLAN based feature enables tagging frames with the VXLAN header. We enter the OSPF routing instance simply to start the OSPF process. We don't need to add anything else to OSPF yet. We define VLAN 1000 for the hosts. The VN segment command maps this VLAN to VNI 5000. Remember that extra VXLAN headers will lead to larger packets. The MTU needs to be increased to allow for this. Keep in mind that the maximum MTU may vary on different platforms. Now, we'll set that routing template from earlier. As I mentioned before, if you're running a newer version of NXOS, you won't need to do this. Changing the routing template needs a reboot, so we'll save the config and do that now. But don't worry, I won't make you watch the whole reboot process. Now to configure port 49 as the routed link with the no switch port command. Next, give it an IP address and add the interface to OSPF. We will be running multicast, so let's set the interface to sparse mode. Let's verify that this is working so far. We can ping, and eventually OSPF neighbors will form. The host ports are quite simple. They're just configured as access ports in VLAN 1000. No special VXLAN config here. We will need loopback interfaces for two reasons. For one, we'll use the loopback IP as the rendezvous point in the multicast topology. Also, the VTEP gets its IP address from the loopback. We'll see both of these in the next section. Make sure all loopback interfaces are added into OSPF, and they are in sparse mode. A second loopback interface is used as the anycast rendezvous point. As this is anycast, it is the same on both switches. And finally, quickly verify that the loopback interfaces are reachable. We'll now move on to configure the rest of the multicast infrastructure. This is a very simple multicast topology. I won't get into how multicast works, as it's way outside the scope of this video. After that, we'll look at configuring the VTEP, also known in the Nexus world as the NVE interface. To start, we'll configure the rendezvous point address. Remember that this is based on the loopback 1 interface, which has the same IP on both switches. The RPs are responsible for a very wide list of multicast groups in this demo. In the real world, you'll want to tighten this up a bit. Next, RP Anycast is configured for these two routers. The Anycast RP address is bound to the real RP address. That's all there is for multicast configuration. Pretty simple, isn't it? Of course, it could get quite complicated in the real world. Now, it's time to configure the VTEP. VTEP is the generic term for the interface that encapsulates traffic. On the Nexus platform, this uses a virtual interface called the NVE interface. The IP address of the NVE is not configured directly. Rather, it is taken from a loopback interface. This is also where we bind VNIs to their multicast groups. This is how bum traffic is handled. If you need more information on multicast and bum traffic, have a look back at part 4. We can verify this with show NVE interface. This NVE interface is up, is configured with VXLAN, uses data plane learning, and gets its IP from loopback 0. The configuration is all done. Were you expecting it to be harder? I know I was when I first started investigating VXLAN. If you're looking for more complication in your life, don't worry, we'll get complicated in part 6 when we look at EVPN. But for now, let's see data plane learning in action. We can use the show NVE peers command to see which VTEPs have already been learned. And there's nothing. Why is that? This is because there's not been any flooding yet. When a host sends an ARP over VNI 5000, it will be flooded to multicast group 230.1.1.1. We can see this with the show NVE VNI command. We can also confirm that this VNI uses data plane learning. Let's jump onto one of the hosts. This one is 192.168.0.10, so we should be able to ping 192.168.0.20. This shows that VXLAN is configured correctly. It also should have flooded an ARP request on the VNI to all VTEPs in the multicast group. Back on the switches, we can now see that the remote VTEPs have been discovered. We'll run through a quick summary of some verification commands. These will help with troubleshooting later. Show NVE interface shows us the learning mode. VXLAN encapsulation shows that this is the VTEP interface. We can also see that it gets its IP from loopback 0. Show NVE VNI also shows the learning mode. This also has a list of all the VNI to multicast group mappings. You can see that VNI 5000 is bound to VNI 1000. Show NVE peers shows discovered VTEPs. As this uses flood and learn behavior, these addresses are cached and will time out. If we go to one of the hosts and run a ping, the VTEPs are discovered again. In the sixth and final part of this series, we'll cover EVPN configuration for control plane learning. If you found this video useful or interesting, please subscribe to the channel and hit the notifications button. Also, let me know what you thought of the video in the comments section. I'll see you in part 6.